when you've had a stroke, you don't have to give up. Maybe it is to wear those molded shoes forever, but whatever it is, don't give up. And that was the message of hope. That was what I wanted to translate to others.
Welcome to At the Heart of It. Nancy Brown, CEO of the American Heart Association, thank you for joining us at the Heart of It, where we are exploring the stories of remarkable people. We're having intimate conversations with our guests about finding purpose, unleashing innovation, and maintaining well-being along the way. Imagine if your superpowers involved walking in 2-inch heels shortly after having a stroke, running for the U.S. Congress and winning, negotiating across political lines and passing bills that improve and save lives. That's my dear friend, Congresswoman Joyce Beatty, who represents Ohio's 3rd District. Today, we are talking about how Joyce moves and overcomes obstacles while prioritizing her self-care.
Connecting people, policy, and politics, one law at a time. Congresswoman Joyce Beatty serves as the U.S. Representative for Ohio's 3rd Congressional District. An Ohio native, Congresswoman Beatty began her political career as a member of the Ohio House of Representatives for the 27th District. During her tenure, she's had several pieces of legislation signed into law, including measures to fight human trafficking and another to empower college students to make better financial decisions. And most recently, Congresswoman Beatty was appointed chair of the Congressional Black Caucus. Not only has Congresswoman Beatty fought in the political arena, she is also a stroke survivor. As an American Heart Association national volunteer, she shares her personal story to emphasize the importance of women's health, committing her life as a supporter of early education, women's equality, and more. Congresswoman Beatty is sure to inspire you, both personally and professionally.
Joyce, welcome. I love that video, and I am so happy you're here with me today.
Well, thank you, Nancy. I am so excited about being here and us having a dialogue and a chat. I'm just excited, and thank you so much.
You know, when I think about your life, handling serious business is what you do every single day. But I thought we would start our time together today with a little bit of fun. So if you're up for it, let's play a game of this or that. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Working style, early morning or late night?
Probably both, but late night.
Multitasker or one thing at a time?
Definitely multitasker.
Exercise, yoga, aerobics, running, walking?
Aerobics.
Oh, dancing. Good. Yeah, dancing is always fun. Food, steak, fish, or tofu?
Fish, without a doubt.
Okay, animal lover, are you a dog person or a cat person?
I'm a dog person.
Me too. All right, so now let's get at the heart of it. And starting on a very serious topic, at the age of 50, you had a stroke. I know you left the hospital in a wheelchair, wearing orthopedic shoes and ankle molded braces, but within a month, you were back on your feet, and soon after that, you were making public appearances in 2-inch heels. You once said you did that to prove a point. What point were you trying to prove?
I think I wanted to send a message that when you've had a stroke, you don't have to give up. And it was very difficult for me at first, but I realized that there was something that I could do to give back because I was a survivor. I had come through it against the odds. And you're right, I wore those molded shoes, which I hated, by the way, very orthopedic like, didn't go well with dresses or pantsuits, but the key was I was walking. And one of the things I say to individuals who've had a stroke, don't give up. Continue to listen to your body. But you have to work overtime and you have to talk about it. And so it was important for me to say to people, one day I will walk. And I did. And then it was, one day I want to show you, if we work hard, if we change our diets, if we exercise, if we listen to our body, that maybe I'll be able to wear those 2-inch heels again. Shortly after that, maybe almost a year, I was wearing those heels to send a message that you too can do whatever your goals are. And maybe it is to master your wheelchair. Maybe it is to wear those molded shoes forever. But whatever it is, don't give up. And that was the message of hope. That was what I wanted to translate to others.
You always have a message of hope. And I wonder if at that moment in your life, someone instilled that message in you. You instill it in so many people. Did someone give you that inspiration at that moment to come out of that hospital with that point of view?
I can say first, my grandmother. My grandmother suffered with cardiovascular disease, and a little later in life than 50, she had a massive stroke where she was paralyzed for the rest of her life. But she was determined to live on her own, to walk. She taught herself how to sign all of her documents with her left hand. So I realized that I had been given a gift because I was a different kind of survivor. She really survived against the odds, and she figured out how to maneuver her home and to not really stop doing many of the things that she was able to do, although she was totally paralyzed. And so I figured she was sending a message to me. And then there was my mother, who pretended that I had never had a stroke. When I had a challenge with speaking and storing up words, she would simply say, "Take your time, you can do it." And so no one ever felt sorry, or no one ever looked at it as a disability. They said it was a gift. It was a gift for me to have an opportunity to relearn, to rechallenge, and to share with others. And that's why anytime you want me and I can tell my story, it makes a difference that someone hears it. And if it's only one person that I give that hope to, that's enough for me.
I love that, Joyce. And you give hope to so many people through your work. And we're going to come to that in a minute. But let's talk about powerful women and inspirational women. Women often feel that they need to work twice as hard as men to succeed. I'd love to know your opinion on that. And what would you say to women who put work over their health and well-being?
Well, I think it's definitely true that we're playing catch up. We know we're not paid the same as our male counterparts. We know that we're not as plentiful in corporate positions, positions like yours, positions like mine. And so this is our time. We now have a female vice president. We have women who are on corporate boards and sitting on your boards, women of color. So I think we are working harder because we are now having more opportunities to break the glass ceiling. But one thing that I will consistently say is that you have to listen to your body, and you should not put anything over health and family, because it is the balanced female. It is the one that understands how to multitask safely, healthy, listening to your body, that will give you the longevity and will make you a better balanced person to walk in the room and know that you're feeling well, to know that you have rested or that you've stopped in the middle of the day. Now, I always push it to the end, but one thing I can say that I did learn from being a stroke survivor, when I get to the point that I feel my body is saying enough is enough, I stop immediately, whether it's in the middle of the day and I stop and put my feet up in my office, close my eyes for a few moments. I am so rejuvenated, and I feel like I can tackle the world when I come out of that. And I can tell you, I've not always done that. I would have another cup of coffee, or I would say just 2 more speeches, 5 more letters to write. And then we see what probably played into my having a stroke: not listening to my body, not eating healthy, not taking the right types of medicine that I should. And that has to be foremost. You have to listen to your medical advisors and you have to look at your body and you readjust, because the healthier you are, the more tomorrows you will have.
So well said. And you know, I love the idea of just pausing during the day, taking a breath, regrouping, you know, feeling really good before you pick up that next task. That is great advice. And I'm sure it's advice that you use every single day, because when I think of all of the things you are doing right this minute, you are a member of Congress. You just, congratulations again, were named chairwoman of the Congressional Black Caucus. You have many national organizations. You're a wife, a mother, and, you know, you do so much. I just am always in awe. So when and how do you take time off for yourself? And what do you do when you're not helping this country be strong and productive?
Well, I'm smiling because there's one thing that just stops me right in my tracks, and that's my two grandbabies. I am so fortunate that they lovingly call me Grammy after the Grammy Award.
Oh, I love that. Yeah.
Your award, and they are my award. So I take time for them, whether it is like this past weekend, playing games, reading with them, exposing them, traveling with them. I enjoy that. And I'm also someone who cooks. I come home and I may spend a half day in the kitchen because it's relaxing to me. And I have girlfriends, and they keep me going. We have Zoom hours now, Zoom happy hour, just so as powerful women that we can unapologetically say we are human and we are girly sometimes, and we like to laugh and have fun. Don't ever put yourself in a box that you are so corporate, that you are so strong, that you're not anything else, because I think that is very unhealthy. Balance is always something that's needed. So find time to do something, whatever that is for you.
I love the Zoom hours. I can imagine you and your girlfriends giggling up a storm because you always make me giggle. So I have a great mental image of that happening. That sounds like a lot of fun. And while you're having fun on one end, you're managing some very serious issues. You know, when I think of your role as a legislator and how you have influenced issues on education, housing, financial literacy, health, infant mortality, you know, these are critical issues to how people in this country are able to survive and thrive every single day. What do you think are the most important legislative priorities right now to support our communities nationwide?
Well, I think since we are still in the midst of COVID-19, when we are looking at the vaccination, those who are getting it and those who are not having it readily available to them, I think it's a three-headed pandemic that transfers into the three top priorities for me in Congress, and certainly as the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, and that is healthcare. Whether it is making sure that women who are under and uninsured have health care. That's why it was so important for us to have a health care package that dealt with those with pre-existing conditions. We also know that when we look at cardiovascular and stroke disease, number one killer for us. So without a doubt, all of the components, COVID and pre-COVID related, healthcare. And then I would say it is also the economics, whether that is job and workforce development, the economy, because we know pre-COVID and even during COVID, minority and female-owned businesses took a loss. 41% of Black American-owned businesses were devastated.
Those are very serious and significant issues, and it makes me so happy that you are leading the Congressional Black Caucus and that you are in Congress helping us make sure that these important issues are solved so that all people everywhere have an equal opportunity for health and well-being and, you know, fulfillment in life. And so it's it always makes me incredibly proud to know you and to hear your passion for these issues that really matter to people. And so when I think about you and your highly effective approach, what is the best advice you've received and who gave it to you?
That's always a difficult question because believe it or not, I have a lot of individuals that I mentor and they give me great advice. probably what I would say the best advice has come from my family, starting when I was very young and consistently through my adult life, to tell me to always think about being fair and being honest and having integrity, but most importantly, to stand up for what you believe and to be unapologetic about who you are. And probably the main thing that I got out of it was to be just as I am, and to always understand to whom much is given, much is expected. So I would say that, and I would say a lady by the name of Charity Early, I learned a lot from her. She wrote a book called One Woman Army, came into my life as a young adult and was very instrumental in me getting my first big break in government as a director when I was only 29 years old. And probably indirectly, Rosa Parks. I had a fixation on her as a young girl when my parents were talking about her around the kitchen table and what she had done that Alabama day in 1955 by not giving her seat up on the bus. Throughout my life, my mother has used in part that as a way to give direction to us, to stand for something and to stand up for whatever that was, and to make it mean something.
You know, it is always, I think, the accumulation of advice from many people that help form, you know, our perspectives and who we are. And one of the things I've always admired about you, Joyce, is you do have strong convictions for what you believe in, and you go for it, which I love. And at the same time, you are a master at working with people who have perspectives that are different than yours. And, you know, you build alliances with people, you nurture other opinions and points of view. Tell us a little bit about that. Tell us how you have come to have that as such an important skill and tool in your toolbox. And how do you use that when you think about short-term, you know, things you're trying to accomplish and building alliances for the longer term?
Let me give you a very short answer. I talk about my mother a lot, but that comes from my father. My mother always said to me the two most important words you could say, thank you. And I say that a lot in speeches because I think it's so important for people to say thank you. But my father probably knew me a little better in some ways. He said, no, you should tell this child the two most important words she needs to learn to say is, I'm sorry, because she's always so forceful, so out there, and she has to learn how to work with others. She has to learn how to disagree without being disagreeable. And so I come from a large family. There are 8 pieces of chicken in a chicken when it's cut up. And sometimes there were 9 people at our table. I always figured out how to get that drumstick. And I've been saying, that's because she's a negotiator and a talker, and she can bring people together. So after that, after I got in Congress, we started saying that I connect people, politics, and policy. And so I try to live by that. If we're going to move the country, it takes people on both sides of the aisle. So when I think of our healthcare caucuses, our heart caucus, when I think of our civility caucus, that's men and women, Democrats, Republicans, Black, white, and other, that we have to work together for the greater cause of the good. And at the end of the day, I really enjoy people. I like talking. I like engagement. And here's what I have learned, especially in later in life and being in Congress. It's going to take people understanding that you have to work together, which means someone has to compromise, someone has to listen, and someone has to lead. And at the end of the day, you have to have someone who's strong enough to figure out how to put it all together. And so I kind of consider myself a fixer. And I think that makes you a good team player and certainly helps when you're in a leadership position like I am.
That's so insightful, Joyce. And, you know, I have this vision of you and your siblings sitting around the table and you negotiating how you're going to end up with exactly what you want. I could see it all happening. So speaking of negotiation, you are a master. But when is the last time you negotiated for yourself? And what did that look like?
I think I negotiate every day for myself. I get up every day and negotiate with someone much greater than me, that I'm making a daily commitment to push myself to do more for the greater good of the people, because that is what is important inside me. It was important for me to run to be the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus. That was something I wanted. So I worked hard to negotiate with others that I could seek and secure this position. I negotiate every day for better health care, for a better quality of life for my grandchildren. But I have to start with me. I have to keep me healthy. And when we're talking about this from the frame of the American Heart Association, you're integrated into so many things. So when I think of negotiating on the House floor for a piece of legislation, whether that's financial literacy, whether that's having a stroke survivor day, or whether that is fighting for $1.9 trillion or a $2 trillion infrastructure bill, I'm really fighting and negotiating for myself so I can have quality of life, quality of air, a good health care plan. Because if you don't start with yourself, if you don't strengthen yourself, if you don't believe in yourself, how can you really fight for the people you represent or even your family or the people you love?
That's wonderful. And, you know, speaking of the Congressional Black Caucus and negotiating, when you took that role, you vowed to break the chains of systemic racism that have held back the Black community far too long. What are your priorities in this critical work?
Well, and our critical work for this is to make sure that we hold all of those accountable, whether that's the leadership in Congress, whether that is the president and vice president of the United States, that we must be united to stand up against any racial injustices. Right now, the number one thing that we're focusing on is the Voting Rights Act. Here we are after the 1964-65 Voting Rights Act and Civil Rights Act, still negotiating to reauthorize it. I think we also have to look at that we work on the systemic and the cultural racism, because we know poverty is a result of racism. Healthcare, or the lack of it, is also a racial issue. It's about inclusion and it's about equity. And it's about knowing that oftentimes for us at a disadvantage, treated disproportionately different or affected disproportionately, the number of disparities, we don't have access to capital. We don't have the same opportunities or communities or neighborhoods. So it's a big package, but I believe working together, starting with healthcare and jobs and education in our communities, we will move the needle.
Well, I am inspired listening to you. And as you know, all of us at the American Heart Association are partners with you on working towards this more equitable world that we envision. It makes me, we started by talking about your grandchildren and how important they are in your life. And I guess I'd love you to fast forward a bit. When you think about all this work you're doing, what does diversity and inclusion look like to you? What do you hope it will be in the future? Or in other words, what kind of world do you want to leave for your grandchildren?
I want this type of conversation to be something that's foreign to them. I want it to be the natural assumption that there is inclusion and equity because they are living it. And I can reflect back 20 plus years ago, when you and I were working together and the board did not have the diversity that I thought it should have. The programs weren't as diverse. But one thing that I am so honored and why I value our friendship so much is you sat down and listened and you put a plan together. And now, if you would have asked me that question then, what would I have wanted 20 years later? I would be able to say, I want just what you've done to that board. I want just what you've done by stepping out of the pure circle of the American Heart Association. Look at you, looking at diversity, looking at racial injustices. And that's what happens when you move the needle because you listen. You create more than task force. You create policy. You get out front and lead. So what you've done over the past 20 years is what I want to pass for the next 20 years when my granddaughter is sitting here talking with someone else that's in your position, talking about the good old times when a Nancy Brown and a congresswoman and former board member Joyce Beatty put this plan together. And look at us now.
And I remember sitting down with you as if it were yesterday, and we talked about what this future state for the American Heart Association needed to look like. And you have been such a wise advisor to me and to the board over all these years. And I'm really proud of what we've accomplished. I'm proud of the 10 commitments we've made to fight systemic racism and health inequities that, you know, are hundreds of millions of dollars of commitment of the AHA. And I think of you every time that we take our work to the next level, because you truly inspired this great organization to realize what a key role we have in helping to change the world and helping to change society and helping individuals have an equal opportunity for prosperity. So I will never thank you enough for that. And it's always a pleasure to have the chance to go back in time as we think about going forward in time. And, you know, speaking about going forward in time, my gosh, this past year we have all felt the struggles brought on by the pandemic. And we've talked a bit about the racial and health inequities that have been revealed to some people, particularly over this past year. We know that laughter is good for the soul and for our health. When is the last time you had a really good laugh, and what were you laughing about?
Well, I hate to keep going back to my grandchildren, but I just had them a few days ago. And children, in their own wise wisdom, are so funny when they ask questions that you don't have an answer for. And she said, "Grammy, I think you're making that up." And then she just started laughing. And she said, "Grammy, because I really know the real answer to my question." I said, "Well, why did you ask me?" She said, "Because you always test us. And I was just testing you, because we have to test adults sometimes." Just the fun that they give me. And it's beyond them being my grandchildren. It's because they are the future. And when I listen to them, they can talk healthcare, they can talk world politics. And those were things at 6 years of age and seven, we certainly weren't doing. I'm so blessed to have children whose eyes are open, and yet they're so naive to this time that we're having right now, between the violence and between what's happening in Congress. And they're fully aware that their grandmother goes to Washington, to Congress, to change the world. And so it's funny when they imitate me. They watch me on C-SPAN on the floor, and they get up and imitate me and recite the laws that I'm doing with a little twist of childhood and humor. So we spent the whole evening laughing at me. And well worth.
So Joyce, like your mother, you often say, "Don't find fault, find a way." Tell us about how that statement really turned into action in your life.
Well, it's interesting. And you know, I talk about family and culture a lot, because it's not unique to me, but for many individuals of my generation, and especially Black Americans, we grew up in the community. It was the neighborhood. It was the church oftentimes, or the community center. But one thing my parents always said, because like all children, I was a normal kid. I complained a lot. I asked for things I knew I wasn't going to get. And one day my mother sat me down and she said, "You shouldn't ask for things or complain without resolve or an answer." And you know, that stuck with me. She said, "One of the most profound gifts you can have is to think and create." She pushed us to read, to do well in school. And I was lucky or blessed or worked hard or a combination of that. My grades were always excellent. But it was interesting that my mother would say, "Grades are grades, but what you make of yourself is how creative you are, how you can come up with your own answers." And she said, "Later in life, when you're older, you will appreciate when you have a staff or a family and they're always complaining, as they will, and there's no answer or resolve. So you should look back at them and say, maybe you should think about having an answer or resolve." And it has bode me well when I'm going into a meeting and I'm thinking about all the things I can complain about, that that's really unfair as a professional and an adult that I didn't make the question and give a suggestion as well. She would tell you, it's easy to find fault, it's harder to find an answer or resolve. So if you're finding fault with something, think about a suggestion or an answer you can give with it. And again, there's that negotiating or making someone feel better. And Nancy, I'll bring it home to the Heart Association. I think I was thinking about that in that first board meeting when I looked at you and so many brilliant, talented physicians and people in the healthcare, you know? And so when I would go to say, and why aren't you doing this? And why aren't you doing this? It was, I don't think we're doing this, but here's something we could look at. We could have a diversity and inclusion committee. We could look at broadening our base of talking to Black physicians who are experts in culture and in healthcare or cardiovascular disease. And you brought in the best. And that was better than me coming in and saying, you don't have this and you don't have that, and stopping there. And look at what we have collectively with all of the board members have done. I mean, I think it is amazing because there was the question, the answer, and the resolve.
You know, that is life-changing advice, Joyce, when you think about putting it together as a package like that, because, you know, people hear and engage when they feel inspired, and coming forward with issues, solutions, resolve, that is how things get done. That's why you are such an incredible success in everything that you do in life. And so finally, on that note, what you just said was inspirational, but I'm going to ask you to go a little bit more in the Joyce background and leave us with something really inspirational to hold on to from your heart, words of encouragement to help us move forward during this time of transition.
I think I would probably say directly to anyone listening that history can't be changed or rewritten, but what we can do is write our future. What we can do is listen to others, listen to our body, listen to our children, and put it all together, because tomorrow can be greater if we work towards it together. And the same things that are our problems that we face every day in this great nation, in this great democracy, can be improved. But it can't be improved by one institution or one person, no matter how great, how powerful, but it can be changed, improved, and built back better if we all do it together.
I love that, Joyce Beatty. Thank you for being such a good friend. Thank you for taking time today. Thank you for inspiring us and giving us a peek into your family and to your wonderful grandchildren and to all you're doing for this country. We are proud to know you, and I am proud to call you a dear friend. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and thank you for including me in this series. And let me just end by saying to you, keep doing it, keep going, because it's truly making a difference.
Thank you, Joyce.
Thank you, my friend.
I have so much respect for Congresswoman Joyce Beatty's resilience to lead during challenging times. She not only speaks truth to power, she is a powerful leader fighting for the issues that impact our daily lives. I learned so much from listening to Joyce, but the thing that really sticks with me from my conversation with Joyce is the focus on how your health gives you more tomorrows. I also loved how Joyce talked about it's not enough to just identify problems, that we need to bring solutions and have the resolve to make a difference in the world. That truly is life-changing advice. I'd love to know what you've taken away from our conversation today and also from this first season of our new show. We are so proud to have brought you some amazing leaders, and we'd love to hear from you. Please subscribe, like, comment, and share. I'm Nancy Brown. Thank you for joining in.